OCPD in film and TV. Let's check the accuracy. What's up, YouTube? How's everybody doing? So we finally have an episode you can enjoy with a bucket of popcorn. Knowing that a picture is worth a thousand words, I thought it was about time I produced an episode with some cinematic examples of OCPD symptoms. It should be said that for the films and television series I'm going to be referencing, it's very possible that this video contains spoilers. Please check the list of movies and TV shows I'll be referencing in the description if you're at all concerned about me ruining things for you. Sort of okay though, as I'm pretty used to that. But everything I'm referencing is at least a few years old, so you'll probably be fine. If not, go check out the movies and come back to this video later. That said, let's talk about what we'll be specifically looking at and what's important to keep in mind. None of the examples I'll be showing you explicitly state that the characters have obsessive compulsive personality disorder, and I'm not saying that they have it either. What I will be showing you are characters in film that display common symptoms or personality traits of OCPD. I'm in no position to diagnose someone in film, no more than I am in real life. Also, many of these characters are assumed to have OCD. That brings me to my second point, which is that with an astonishing regularity, most of the time personality disorders are combined, misrepresented, or muddled in film. This doesn't bother me as much as it does some people. It is to be expected that a director and writer would take artistic license with mental health as they do with all other things in movies. On top of this, there are so many people involved in these projects that even if they started with an accurate representation in the script, by the time it gets to the public, there's an almost zero chance of it making it through unscathed. If you're familiar with these films or if you go back and watch them, let me reiterate that many of the characters we will be looking at most likely have OCD, OCD combined with OCPD, or neither, and they've just been written up with traits that match up well with what to expect with obsessive compulsive personality disorder. I guess the last disclaimer is that some of these characters are not people with which you'd want to be associated with. Again, there are many subtypes of OCPD to keep in mind, and most of the time, mental health issues are not written as something subtle. These are supposed to be entertaining portrayals, so exaggeration is highly likely. Oh, and I'm not familiar with all of the television shows I'm referencing, so if I screw something up, feel free to attack me in the comments. All right, enough of me, let's jump into the good stuff. The first example is the film As Good As It Gets. For many, this is the film that pops into their head when they think of OCD. This movie is a prime example of muddling up a bunch of disorders into one and at the same time not being consistent with any of them. But this video isn't about ripping apart inaccuracies, but rather illustrating symptoms I've talked about in past videos. The first scene depicts two mannerisms that could be tied to OCPD. The first is repeatedly checking the locks. Although highly repetitious rituals are not closely tied to the disorder, it might be possible to justify that the locks need to be turned a few times to really make sure you've done it well. But the flicking of the lights is more of the sort of ritualistic behavior of OCD. The extreme hand washing is something I've personally experienced. I've washed my hands many times to the point at which they're bleeding. For me, it's the sensation of oil or grease, but more commonly, it would be for germs. The way he does it with multiple bars of soap is on the extreme end of things, but again, this isn't a subtle portrayal. Honestly, I'm just jealous he can afford to invest in that much soap. The next scene is an example of not having the ability to filter yourself. Whether it's because your internal moral rules don't allow for anything but brutal honesty, or you're just too caught up in your own way of thinking that you don't understand the impact your words may have. This is a humorous look at being blunt. The character of Melvin doesn't want to be disturbed and doesn't understand why someone would not get that.
No, I wasn't aware. Do you like to be interrupted when you were nancing around in your little garden?
I actually will turn the ringer off of my phone and sometimes put a piece of cardboard.
Well, I work all the time. So never, never interrupt me, okay? Not if there's a fire. Not even if you hear the sound of a thud from my home and 1 week later, there's a smell coming from there that can only be a decaying human body. And you have to hold a hanky to your face because the stench is so thick that you think you're gonna faint. Even then, don't come knocking.
This scene here has two traits of OCPD tying into each of the last two scenes. The first being his inability to use the silverware provided at a restaurant. This calling back to his aversion to germs.
3 eggs over easy. 2 sausage, 6 strips of bacon with fries.
Fries today.
The second is when he makes mention of the waitress Carol's sick son in a nonchalant and hurtful way.
You're gonna die soon with that diet, you know that.
Yeah, we're all gonna die soon. I will, you will, and it sure sounds like your son will.
He has affection for the character of Carol, so his intention is not malicious, but rather his inability to soften his words makes him come across as uncaring. He is caught up in his routine, and this is a horrific result of that. In this scene, with a psychiatrist, Marvin demonstrates how someone with OCPD would find it difficult to effectively cooperate with a professional.
Dr. Green, how can you diagnose someone as an obsessive compulsive disorder and then act as though I had some choice about Bart?
It's very tough to find a therapist that someone with this disorder wouldn't find a reason for dismissing. Most people with this personality disorder never even make it as far as a psychiatrist's couch, as they're likely to never come to terms with the fact that they have any sort of disorder in the first place.
My beard, but you're not interested in changes in me.
Shh, I don't have this mountain of available time. I have to get to my restaurant on time. Now, do you know how hard it was for me to come here?
Yes. No, we're not doing this now.
I changed just one pattern, as you always said I should.
No. Nope.
Here, we have a really good scene illustrating the rigidity one experiences surrounding rules, morality, and ethics.
I'm hungry. You've ruined my whole day. I haven't eaten.
What are you doing here?
This is not a sexist thing. If you were a waiter, I'd be saying...
Are you totally gone? This is my private home.
What can make these things difficult in being around someone with OCPD is that not only will they hold themselves to unrealistic standards in the pursuit of perfection, there is a likelihood that they will also try and hold you to these standards as well, all the while completely unaware of how they are coming across or how much damage they are causing.
Do you have any control over how creepy you allow yourself to get?
Yes, I do. As a matter of fact, and to prove it, I have not gotten personal and you have. I'm gonna jump in the shower.
Okay.
I'll be right with you.
Okay.
In these funny final two scenes, we again get a taste of the inflexible nature of OCPD. In both situations, Melvin is oblivious to the inconvenience he is causing in his rigid need to meet his own cleanliness standards.
Set.
He is slightly more aware in the second example, but he doesn't find it at all unreasonable to keep his date waiting while he literally goes shopping.
Yes, we do. Oh, and I can give you a tie and jacket.
What?
Oh, they require a tie and jacket, but we have some available. Sir?
No, I'm not putting that on. And in case you were going to ask, I'm also not going to let you inject me with the plague
either. It's such a nice place. You probably have these dry cleaned all the time, don't you?
Actually, I don't think so.
Yeah. Well, you just wait here. Excuse me.
Just to catch you up with what's happening here, part of his OCD is the inability to step on a crack, hence not being able to enter the store.
No.
That one.
This one.
That one, yeah. And this tie.
The last thing I'll mention before moving on to the next example is that in cinema, it is really common for love to cure whatever mental health issue is ailing the protagonist. This seems to upset a lot of people in real life, as not only is it highly unlikely, it's virtually impossible for love alone to be the solution to your mental disorder problems. As people have to date in the real world, they find it incredibly frustrating that other people think they can cure them if they just love them enough. Next up is a quick example from the 90s television show Frasier, which was a spin-off from the TV show Cheers. One of the central characters is Dr. Niles Crane. In this scene taking place at one of the show's regular locations, Cafe Nervosa, in an entertaining way, Niles demonstrates an intolerance on the part of someone with OCPD to accept anything less than perfection in others. He is portrayed as a pretty mild-mannered character, but even so, when suffering with OCPD, there is a compulsion to speak up, no matter the risk to one's social standing.
I rather like this new system. It's lively.
Well, it's more efficient. What can I get for you?
I'll have a double short, low-fat, no-foam latte.
Double short, low-fat, no-foam latte.
Double short, non-fat, low-foam latte.
Double short, non-fat, no-foam latte.
Excuse me, I think there was a problem in the chain of command. The middle person reversed part of it. She said a double short, non-fat, low-foam latte.
Double short, non-fat, yeah. Low-foam latte.
Double short, non-fat, low-foam latte.
Double short, non-fat, no-foam latte.
No, you did it again. That's not what I want.
Well, you can just tell yourself.
All right. I'll have a double short, low-fat, no-foam latte.
Double short, low-fat, no-foam latte.
Double short, low-fat, no-foam latte. Nutmeg?
Nutmeg?
Nutmeg? No, thanks.
For the next character, I'm just going to let this compilation of clips run. Death the Kid is one of the main protagonists in the manga series Soul Eater. In essence, Death the Kid is a grim reaper with an obsessive-compulsive nature focused on symmetry. What is interesting is that his father, Lord Death, is the embodiment of law and order. As there may be a strong correlation to OCPD and nurture, it's fitting that law and order are the two components most strongly attached to his father. So here are some pretty comical examples of the obsessive-compulsive mind.
Idiot, what do you think you're doing? Eyebrow grooming is to be left up to me! What happens if the left and right sides are uneven? Ugh, I'm a failure. A complete failure. What kind of grim reaper am I if I can't even remember to fold the toilet paper?
What's that? What did you say, seven?
No, it can't be seven! Say eight, damn it! Eight is better!
Well, maybe it's my imagination, but I have this horrible feeling that the painting that I have hanging in my living room is leaning a little bit to the right.
Does that painting really matter?
Oh. Awful.
It's not neat enough.
The freak's still writing his name.
It's impossible to cut the number 7 in half and make it symmetrical. It has to be 8 instead. 8 cut in half vertically or horizontally stays perfectly symmetrical.
Three stripes on the left side of your hair and none on the right? That doesn't look symmetrical to me.
You're right, I'm an abomination. I'm filthy and dirty and unbalanced. Why is there only one set of stripes? I'm garbage, asymmetrical garbage.
One of the disadvantages to the way this disorder is portrayed in media is that you rarely see how someone is affected when they are on their own. The flip side is that many of these stories seek to show the impact this disorder has on those that are around someone with OCPD. In the television show Desperate Housewives, the character of Bree is in the hospital with her husband Rex, whom she has accidentally just poisoned with a food he is allergic to. He apparently has asked for a divorce and explains why in this scene depicting how hard it can be to understand why someone with OCPD is so rigid.
I'm sick of you being so damn perfect all the time. I'm sick of the bizarre way your hair doesn't move. I'm sick of you making our bed in the morning before I've even used the bathroom. You're this plastic suburban housewife with her pearls and her spatula who says things like, "We owe the Hendersons a dinner." Where's the woman I fell in love with? Who used to burn the toast and drink milk out of the carton? And laugh? I need her.
In the movie Sleeping with the Enemy, we have one of the most consistent portrayals of obsessive-compulsive personality disorder. The downside is that the character of Martin is also a psychopath. So for the sake of all of us, let's please keep these things separate. Laura is married to Martin, a charming and wealthy investment counselor. It's in the beginning of the film that you are made aware of Martin's obsessive-compulsive behavior and how it drives his anger. In this first scene, we get to see his obsession with order and control. And in the second scene, we see the devastating effect this has on his wife and the quality of her life. This is also one of the harder examples to watch.
Everything in here as it should be?
I don't know why I forgot.
Well, we all forget things. That's what reminding is for.
Thank you.
Now, for Desperate Housewives and this next show, House MD, I'm not at all familiar with them. Going off of research and what other people with OCPD have told me as regards the likelihood the character of Dr. Gregory House having the disorder, people feel strongly that he demonstrates a lot of characteristics that align with OCPD. I like this scene as it presents a character that has his own obsessive nature, and it shows him recognizing this quality in House. It's a scene that hits home for me, and it shows the sad and lasting effects of not getting treatment for your mental health issues.
Well, apparently you know me better than I know you.
I know that limp. I know the empty ring finger. And that obsessive nature of yours, that's a big secret. You don't risk jail in your career to save somebody who doesn't want to be saved unless you got something, anything. One thing. The reason normal people got wives and kids and hobbies, whatever, that's because they ain't got that one thing that hits them that hard and that true. I got music, you got this. The thing you think about all the time, the thing that keeps you south of normal. Yeah, makes us great, makes us the best. All we miss out on is everything else. Little woman waiting at home after work with the drink and the kiss. That ain't gonna happen for us.
That's why God made microwaves.
Yeah. When it's over, it's over.
For the movie The Odd Couple, we also have a very close portrayal of OCPD. Along with that, it's treated really respectfully and fairly accurately. I'm showing the scene not just because it illustrates his obsession with cleaning, but in a few brief seconds, you're really exposed to the mental anguish that is caused by having this disorder. The desire to be understood, not judged, and wanting to just be left alone to pursue these obsessions uninterrupted.
The irony is that unless we come to some other arrangement, I'm gonna kill you. That's the irony of it.
The character of Felix is hurt because he is causing his roommate Oscar a lot of aggravation, and he is also hurt because he feels attacked for doing what he believes is the right thing to do.
A big eight-room apartment should have a cleaner house than my mother.
Well, wait, what are you talking about? I didn't say that you have to do it. You don't have to clean up.
Well, what you do is worse. You're always in my bathroom hanging up my towels. Whenever I smoke, you follow me around with an ashtray. Last night, I found you in the kitchen washing the floor, shaking your head and moaning, footprints, footprints.
I didn't say they were yours.
Well, they were mine, damn it. I have feet and they make prints. What do you want me to do, climb across the cabinets?
No, I just want you to walk on the floor.
Oh, well, I appreciate that. I really
do. All I'm trying to do is keep this place livable. I didn't know I irritated you that much.
Leave my picture. Alone.
I was just trying to even them up.
I want them uneven. They're my pictures. Even up your own pictures.
I was wondering how long it would take.
How long what would take?
Before I got on your nerves.
Not to stay too serious, the next film is a comedy. The plot to Turner and Hooch isn't really relevant here, as I'm only going to show half of the opening credits. It's also not relevant because how have you not seen every 80s movie starring Tom Hanks? There really is no excuse. Not much to say other than here is a great montage of potentially obsessive compulsive symptoms. Also, it's a long montage and I cut it short, so keep in mind that the punchline at the end of this sequence is that he is just getting ready for bed. I can so relate. This final example was something that was suggested recently. I rediscovered not only what a good film this was, but how well it illustrates a side of OCPD not often thought of. Flash of Genius is a biographical film focusing on the life of inventor Robert Kearns and his legal battle against Ford Motor Company after they developed an intermittent windshield wiper based on his patents. The first two scenes I'm showing here are with his wife Phyllis, and they show how insecure and full of self-doubt someone with this personality disorder can be. Not only is it common for someone with OCPD to have unrealistic expectations of themselves, but it demonstrates that we may have a grandiose idea of who we should be and how not meeting that expectation leads to disillusionment and depression.
Are you gonna quit teaching?
You think I should?
I think you should take it a step at a time.
Well, so you're saying it's not gonna last?
No, saying love you either way.
Which is French for be prepared to fail.
Robert.
No, I just wanna do something important.
You will.
Will you love me more if I do?
No, I love you more if you're rich.
Makes you wonder what it is makes a man successful. Brains? Talent? Of course, there's a lot of unsuccessful talents running around out there.
Maybe this is the one. Maybe this will get you where you want to be, you know?
Yeah.
But I don't know. I look at you and I look at us and I just think, you're a success. Don't you feel that way?
Maybe it's some other thing, like luck, timing, some intangible thing like that. It haunts me a little.
In the next scene with Robert and Phyllis, we get to see the frustration that comes from him realizing that not everything is under control. Although in the film, Robert is portrayed as someone that deeply loves his family, he doesn't seem to have the ability to stop himself from putting his obsessions ahead of them. But he is also able to see himself at times, and you sense his frustration in not being able to align who he is with who he wants to be.
Considering using electronic intermittent wiper control.
Do you want to list who?
Yes, and that these are in direct violation of patents jointly held by both Previc and Kearns Corporation. As the inventor of the intermittent wiper, I demand that they take immediate legal action.
Demand is too strong. They're our friends.
What difference does it make? They're not going to read it anyway.
Why are we doing this?
Because it makes me feel better.
Does it?
Where's this file? Who's this?
Kathy won it in the swim meet. She wanted you to see it.
In this heartbreaking final scene near the very end of the film, Robert has won the battle that has taken up 12 years of his life, cost him his wife, and caused so much hurt within his family. It shows how even when the costs are as high as they could ever be in life, someone with OCPD can find that they've been so singularly focused and obsessed on what they perceive to be justice, they can finally lift their head up to find they've lost everything they've ever cared about. It's a sad ending, but a fitting one.
Congratulations, Robert. You finally got everything you wanted, and you deserve it.
No, not everything. I don't get the last 12 years back.
I suppose not.
But it's over.
I don't think so. No. It'll never be over. There'll always be another battle. That's just you.
Yeah.
I don't want to end the video on that note, however. What I do want to do instead is leave you with a scene from one of my all-time favorite movies. Harvey is a film about Elwood P. Dowd, an eccentric man whose best friend is a pooka, which is a creature of Celtic folklore. The existence of the pooka, which takes the shape of an invisible 6-foot-tall rabbit, shapes Elwood's philosophy of life. This philosophy of life is something I've thought about ever since being diagnosed with OCPD, and I will continue to think about it every day I'm on this planet. I believe in it wholeheartedly, even if I find it very difficult to implement. So I'll leave you guys with this, and as always, I'm Daryl, and this is still my life in debris.
You know, years ago, my mother used to say to me, she'd say, in this world, Elwood, you must be, she always called me Elwood. In this world, Elwood, you must be oh so smart, or oh so pleasant. Well, for years I was smart, I recommend pleasant. And you may quote me.